Just to come back to her question that says, that asked, are there any trends? Let's go and try to, in the next hour, let's try to examine one of the current... current trends. That is an industry current trends related to games, that's gamification. So what is gamification? The standard definition says that basically gamification is use the elements of, you know, of games and game design techniques in non-game contexts. This is the standard, standard definition. I really like a different one that says the use of elements of play in non-game contexts. It's a kind of different because it focuses really basically on the action you require to people to do that, and to the fact that it should be a playful experience. And I think that well, gamification is really trendy, but also several people that approach it, it basically underestimate the difficulty in doing that, or they simplified it a lot. When you talk about game elements, you're not talking in a game studies way, you're not talking about the player, the objective, the rules, blah, blah, blah. But basically the elements of the game that players usually see. So I usually play a game because I want to have a high score, right? Or I want to get a lot of gold, or I want to do several stuff. So the elements of play that that people see typically is the fact that, for instance, you play with an avatar. So you have... you know, the idea that you can change your identity and be something. You have a sense of progression when you level up and you become level 2, level 3, and you progress either in the game, in the levels, or either you as a character, like in World of Warcraft. You have the typical points, etc. You have the social interaction that is kind of... must-do in most of the games today. So what is the goal of a gamification? Several people say several goals. Typically, it's, well, what I like is that you have to engage users in an activity. So you have an activity in mind, like I want to have people running, because running is nice. So basically, I do something that, in a sense of way, they engage them while trying to do this thing that is can be boring, okay? Because you're at home, you're on the couch, and you say, I should run. Yeah, I should run at least once a week. I should run, but it's Sunday. I work all day, and I'm on the couch, and there is Ginnaste Vite Parallele on the TV, and I watch this. Oh, it's nice. Why I should? Abito da sposa cerca, sì. And I say, should I go there or should I just relax? Or should I play the PlayStation? Get the control of the video and play the PlayStation. So the idea is that can I engage the user so much that they can do this this extra work and do it? So for instance, Samsung asks itself, can I have the users more active on my website because I want, I want loyalty from them and I want to increase the their presence. So what they did was to put up Samsung Nation, which was a system that allows you to get points just because you were exploring the website, right? And here, right now, I will consider you on the other side, so you're looking at this as a game designer. So basically, here, you're trying to attract the explorers, the ones that they want to, for instance, see many things. But you want also to use the achievers, that are the one that wants to collect points and stuff like this. So you might have extra content, okay? So if you go around, you get stuff, I can give you the preview of the new product, or I can give you some points and some badges, etc. Obviously, as I said, for running, one of the most successful gamification experiences actually came out before gamification was even a word, and was it's a Nike Plus. So I had my Nike Plus, I would say, in 2006, 2007 first. And actually, it was very nice because you had these things in the shoes. It actually also increased the loyalty in the shoes because if you want Nike Plus, the pod that you could use to track your steps could only be put inside a Nike shoe. So Nike increased the selling of the shoes a lot. And there were these challenges, like there's been everybody today, let's go out and let's make 10 kilometers, right? And there was this counter that everybody went up. And it was way before that COD or Call of Duty or Battlefield had this mission, like let's kill 1 million people this weekend, which is actually one of the Call of Duty and Battlefield things. You can use it to convince people to use better the engine. So for instance, here, there is a Ford hybrid where you, if you use the car well, like, you know, you don't accelerate too much and you don't consume too much gas, so you have a good weight of driving, the tree that you see on the side, it grows, right? And actually, it's very interesting because I just, for the first time, last weekend, I drove a hybrid, Yaris, I think. And it was something like there was you are in eco mode. You are there was this green stuff where you were there. You feel good because you were really, really, really nice. And actually, I drove much better than usual. I mean, you know, not accelerating too much, not braking when it was useless, etc. And it's really interesting. One of the most effective things in gamification is, for instance, that counter that says, you know, typically you would just subscribe to something like LinkedIn. But you wouldn't say just, I will tell you just the name and my email address and that's it. But then you have this indicator in the profile. Your profile is only 30% complete. Don't you want to complete your profile? Come on. And every time you go there, you see 30%. And you say, I want really to see that thing green all over and I have to see a complete profile. And you're pushed through that. Windows, Microsoft used it for checking out the language of Windows 7 before it came out. It made a game where everybody could participate from his workforce, and basically would try to correct the errors in any mask of Windows 7, and it was a real increase in that. From the application you see, there are three main types of application. First of all, you can have it external. And external means that I want to attract customer, I want to do something about, increase my the access of customer to my website and their loyalty, blah, blah, blah. So I use that. I can have internal. So for instance, I've seen a presentation where there is a company which is called A Little Bit. It's actually the owner of gamification.it, the website. And there is a description there. They did this application, this gamified application, about yellow pages. And the idea was that each vendor of yellow page services would basically see the performance of this group on the map. It was not really a game, for instance. It was just a nice way to depict their sales results. But actually, the fact that you see that your office is a little bit lower than others, and that if the lower one, the upper ones, they win some kind, maybe, of thing, it was kind of interesting to push to increase sales in that. It can be one of the interesting part for me, it's behavior change. Meaning, can I change the behavior of people just trying to have an engaging experience that it can be really particular in that sense? Obviously, if you look at the gamification, if you have enough ears, you see that the gamification, it is, you cannot avoid thinking that the gamification is another, one of these other moments in history of computer science and our society when there is something that is trendy. So, you know, in 2008, there was YouTube and everybody should have a viral video. Then it was, you had to have a blog and then you had to be on Facebook. There is a middle part here that was that should be there, that at some point in history, everybody thought that they should have a shop inside the Second Life. And right now, I don't know whether Third Life came out, but Second Life, I'm not sure that they have any base. But there were several trends, and actually, it's if you are in technology, then you know that it always happens. Now, where gamification starts from? Well, starts from the early marketing campaigns, which was like, for instance, the Cracker Jack. It was the first box of crackers where you could have a toy. Or you could have something like you, for instance, in Italy, you could find small collectibles, like cards that could be you could collect. So when, for instance, and these are the Italian ones, so, for instance, when my mother would collect, I don't know, one of the products, it could be Dash, it could be Ava Lavatrice, whatever it was, inside the big boxes, and where boxes high like this and fall like this, the kids would just jump to the box, dig into the box, and find a small envelope, in something like 5 kilograms of powder, you know, washing powder. It would dig and find out something like this, which were really considered something that was important. When I was preparing this presentation, I didn't thought that in several places they don't have Boy Scouts around, but they never thought about the gamification of the Boy Scout experience. So, for instance, when you are a Boy Scout, you can get badges for doing special things, and so you become an athlete because you had the sort of exams where they ask you to do some stuff, and so you had all these badges on the side of your arm. And so you can have several things, okay? And so it's really interesting because the kids, okay, what is being a Boy Scout? Well, for me, it was meeting once a week. You could go, for instance, on a trip on the mountain, etc., etc. So, for instance, at some point, the Baloo, our scouts, they came and says, "Now we are going to teach you how to do, you know, the first type of emergency, just band-aids and stuff like this." It explained us some stuff. He asked us some stuff. At the end, we had a badge with a red cross symbol here, which means that we could do some basic first aid, right? The great deal with the gamification came out when there was the serious game movement was born. And it's actually the Serious Game Initiative and the Games for Change Initiative. There were these two initiatives, big initiative about using game for change the behaviors and making people learn some stuff. And we will a little bit discuss Serious Game later. Games for Change is really interesting because it's an annual event. For instance, it was part of it. It was also Obama involved several years ago. And it's really the idea that the people meet and they share their experience about using games for change, for improving our society. Commercially speaking, what happens right now is that we have several services that allows you to have a sort of predetermined or some things that you can just add to your anything you do, and you can have your gamification added. So sort of gamification as a service. So you don't have just to modify your thing, but there is only a library, some function, and then you can add the badges and stuff like this, which is very nice from some point because I have a server that takes into account all the leaderboard points, or whatever. But on the other hand, it's also in my opinion, it's also the more simple way to do gamification. A big thing about this idea of using games came out when Jay McDonigal published Reality is Broken, where basically she makes a very simple analysis. He said, okay, people playing World of Warcraft, they spend something like millions of hours on playing World of Warcraft. What if we can make something that is interesting for the society, playable like World of Warcraft? Then people might help us. So, for instance, there is a very famous result about protein folding, where they put a protein folding problem modeled as a puzzle playable for everybody, because actually research is always a puzzle, but they made protein folding as a puzzle game, and actually the result of people all over the world playing that game were much better than the computer-aided tools, for instance. Now, what is interesting, what I found interesting, that's my, what I like more, because it's not that simple, it requires much more creativity, is how you change behavior in people, giving a playful experience and using kind of a game concept, but not the idea of game design. Some elements of what makes game fun, you can use them also in other contexts. I will show you three examples.
Hi, I'm Kevin Richardson. I'm the winner of Volkswagen's Fun Theory Award. My idea was the speed camera lottery.
Quella è la speed camera lottery. This is the speed camera lottery. So the idea is that how do you slow down people on a road, on a city road?
Change human behavior for the better.
And I was so there really was a proposal by Volkswagen, I think. So
idea,
he submitted the idea.
He submitted the idea, and
basically he won. And so Volkswagen implemented it. The idea is very simple. So you have a speedometer in a road, in a city road, where you basically put there, and you say, you know, those signs where you are going 30 miles per hour. And that's red if you are over the limit. So the idea, if you are below the limit, you are green, and that's okay. If you are above the limit, maybe you get the ticket. But the ticket becomes the money submitted to a lottery. So if I spent past year and I was okay, I was 45 kilometers per hour. I had the green light. So take the picture of my car, and basically I enter a lottery where basically the money that I win, I can win the money that the people pay for fines because they speed up. So in a certain way I go slower, both because otherwise I take a ticket maybe, but also because I participate in the lottery. So you have a reduction of speed of 9 kilometers per hour. Which is a lot, which is very simple, right? As an experiment. So you, how do you, think about this. Before I show you this thing, suppose that you have to slow down cars there. What would you do? Well, one solution, for instance, that's highly used in India, when I have a friend in India, I traveled there several times, is, for instance, to put the bump. And actually, I remember that there is a part outside Bangalore that's where basically there is a bump every 5 meters because everybody can put a bump. I decide that in front of my car, in front of my house, they are running too much. I want to be sure that they don't kill somebody. I put a bump. So there are places where you continue going to bump every time. That's very funny. So that's one solution. I could put, you know, policemen there every time. And so, but what would you be your feeling as a user? You would be there always with the police in front of you trying to get your thing. So can you change the behavior, slow down the people without arrest them in a certain way, right? This one, basically I asked my students in the gamification course to build it. This is the infinite bin. It's amazing. So it's very simple. If you have an Arduino, you can build it in 2 minutes. So you put this. Every time you drop, there is a sensor that makes basically an infinite sound, like there is an amazing hole. And this is the reduction of people. So the funny thing is that people were looking around for trash to put them inside because they wanted to feel the noise, right? So you had an increase of 50% of trash collected, right? You see the guy, he went to find the trash to put it there, right?
Oh, no.
If you think the technology is very simple, that's why I said I prefer the idea of play instead of game design. So is there a game design issue here? Not really. I mean, yes, there is something. Going back to one question that was in that side, it's like an Easter egg inside the game, right? You have an Easter egg inside the game, something happens, if you do something weird, then you want to do it again, again, again. So that's what happens. There are several of them. There is one Well, I can show it to you. There is one about using mat to clean your shoes. This is more gamey. So So I have to wait where the... So this is a game, but more or less it's a game, right? And that's funny because what builds up is exactly what you had in an arcade machine, in arcade room. You are too young, but actually in arcade room, one plane, there was one plane and another one watches. And these are other videos. There is also a mat where they put a mat for music. It's actually very interesting. So what is gamification and what is not? I hope that, you know, the first one that I showed you, the first example, you would say, yes, you have badges, points, and the usual stuff. But these three examples, actually, they are completely different, right? So you cannot say that, you know, everything is... gamification is just make a game about this. That's not, you know, or use any games in a workplace. They are not just point badges and leaderboards. That's actually typically people will... both the consultant, both the customer, they sometimes expect this. They say points. If I put points and badges, people will actually do that. Okay, it's not actually about making games. You might avoid completely making games. The infinite bin is not a game. Actually, it's playful, but it's not a game. And so it's more about the design of the experience, of the user experience, rather than the game itself. It's knowing what you are trying to achieve. So, for instance, in all the examples I showed you, at the end, they didn't say, you know, oh, the bin is very funny. Ha, 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 how much I laugh about the bin. But they could measure what was the effectiveness of the bin. Because suppose that the bin was you only used to play, it's not effective in what is your goal. One of the things that it's a major mistake, in my opinion, is that people would say, and actually they came to me several times, you have several students, can we ask a student to build a game for dot, 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 doing this? Because we have a few users, and we want to increase our users, and I think that if we have a game, we increase our users. That's crap. Because actually, if just having a game would, means having several users, it would mean that all the games would be successful. Actually, there are games on the App Store that have never been downloaded, or downloaded once or twice. So, and that's also because, games, per se, they don't acquire customers. They're basically, if they are a good game, and you have a lot of marketing, then you might get customers. And also, when you're doing gamification, your major issue is retention. So you want to have customers, you want to have players, you want to keep them. And it's not about competition, actually. Okay, it's not about competition. Many people think that I have people working for me. I will put, and they work for as much. But then, you know what, I want to make them work more. I will give them badges, leaderboard, and they will, just because they are competitive, they will play. If you remember, when I showed you the classification of people, of players, not all the players are competitive. Not all the players care about having one extra badge. Maybe some players want to have something different, and that's what happens. So the foundation of gamification as a concept is that basically, if you consider, everything can be competentially fun. And there is nobody that can tell you this more than Mary Poppins.
In every job that must be done, there is an element of fun. You find the fun and snap, the job's a game. And every task you undertake becomes a piece of cake, a lark, a spree. It's very clear to see that a spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down, the medicine go down, medicine go down. Just a spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down in a most delightful way.
So this is actually one of the concepts, and you may say, yes, but it's, I wouldn't believe that. As a kid, I wouldn't believe that, right?
Feathering his nest has very...
It's very, actually, it's very funny to watch everything. The thing you might say, you know, I cannot believe that. Sure, but if you would go 10 years ago to a company, I would say, to the gaming company, I would say, I would make a game where you basically just grow a garden, add some fruits and stuff, and what you do then? Oh, I tell people, I did, you know, I have a new cow, I have a new fruits. Did you see my new fruits? Oh my God, that's the fruit is amazing. Or I have a beauty salon, you know, I deal with a beauty salon. Or I serve tables, you know, a very good game that where I serve tables. They would basically, would you just kick out of the door? You said, you know, is you're not doing, you know, Rainbow Six. You're doing something, some really weird stuff. So we are not really interested in that game. But people play these games. They enjoy playing something that is basically a work for somebody else. Actually, the first time I had the gold edition of Sims, meaning the gold disc, the first one that was not even the game itself. There was this guy that worked for the incredible the game machine. That was an Italian magazine. He showed me the Sims, the first Sims. He made me there, and I was this character there, and I was there. Now you can cook. Okay, I cook. And then you can think, I can do this thing. Then suddenly a fly appears inside the room, and I said, why there is a fly in my house? He said, because you don't clean. Now you have to clean. So basically I said, do you think that I'm going to stay here in my computer and doing a life that is exactly what I have in my real life? I have to clean my room, and I have to clean the room also in the game? No, I don't. But actually, people play that in a certain fantasy world. They like it because there is an identity play. I can be, you know, I can be a rock star in The Sims, whatever, right? I can build my own career. And the foundation of a game, the gamification loop. So, what do you do in the gamification? You present challenges to the users. You give them some win conditions, something, because you have to have the objective, and you have also some leaderboards and badges that allows you to measure your advances, your progression. And basically what happens is that you also have a kind of social network to show up and deals, and this basically brings you some status. So you become something, you have a status inside your world, and that's becoming, it's important to you. You might say that, no, it's not important to me, but actually in gamification, status is almost everything. And actually it comes as something that comes out historically. It comes out historically, and status is not something that, you know, I'm a professor, that's my status. It's not this. It's that the status, the badges and your status is the money, the thing that the company gives you for your loyalty, okay? So what happens, this comes out? So several years ago, so in 1800, there was a sugar. This was this company about for sugar. They would say, "Buy 10 boxes, and I give you one more." So, if you were loyal to the company, you buy $10. I give you one more. What is the value of that one more? It is one box. Okay. So, in 1930, there was the first stamps sold, and basically, what the idea was, you buy some stuff. I give you stamps. You collect the stamps. And if you have 10 stamps, 100 stamps, I give you something extra. This was an amazing, amazing, amazing steps into the gamification world and inside the marketing world, because suddenly we lost the connection of between what they give you as a reward and the money and the value it has. Okay, so if I tell you, okay, most of you will probably have some loyalty card from Esselunga, from PAM, or for other. If I ask you how much is worth, what is the value of the money in one point of Esselunga or PAM or others, you don't have it clear. Yes, you are engineers or designers, you have a high degree, so you probably can compute somehow, but generally speaking, it's lost. You know, that people say something like, oh, they gave me this, you know, they gave me this pen and I had only 10,000 points of Esselunga. And you say 10,000 points, it means, you know, for instance, 2 years of shopping at Esselunga, right? But there is this lost in the thing. But this still would give you something back, right? Esselunga gives you something for the points back. Then you have the companies. The companies, they invented the loyalty systems like the airlines. They give you what? They give you, you travel a lot of with us, you have a lot of mileage. I can give you an upgrade, right, in the seat. The upgraded seat is a service, but it's also status, or they give you the possibility to enter their room. You are waiting at the airport. If you have 1,000 miles in the last 1 week, I can give you access to the airport, to the room in the airport. Oh, nice. So it becomes something that is still, the value is still disappearing. And then suddenly you have gamification with a virtual reward. I give you, you do stuff, and I give you a badge. The badge basically costs nothing, okay? But what gives you is status. So you have something that changes from money to status. And actually, if you see this, you see that basically the loyalty cost, the cost to get a loyalty customer, decreases, whereas our value for the status and social power increases. Okay, so it basically means the companies are spending much less, giving us something that is not intangible, like status, and we like it. And if you see this, these are two winners of the, two participants of the MasterChef, not this edition, the previous edition. And if you consider this, these people go through a hell, because I would never participate to MasterChef even if I could cook really well, because actually I don't want to have people tell me, oh, this is bad, this is stupid, they say, you shouldn't be, and I cry, and something like this. These people do that stuff. They do it for the money at the advantage. The winner of one of these things earn not enough to build a restaurant. It's not that he's winning 5 million euros and it changes his life completely. Probably it's 200,000 euros, 100,000 euros. It's not enough to build a restaurant. So why they participate? For the status. And so the currency of those processes is status, access, and power. So status is exactly what you think, and actually it also included the three elements, major elements of gamification: points, leaderboard, and badges. Okay, the three things. You earn 10 points, you have this badge, and you are third on the leaderboard. Okay, so it includes everything. So in a certain way, status is perfect, but it's also work only in a constructed environment. It doesn't mean in the real world, it doesn't mean nothing. It only works in that. Okay, and defines just the relative position in that group, and that's what makes the status. It's kind of badges, levels, and leaderboard. Those are the three things. Otherwise, you could have access. So, for instance, there was this the guild group would say, okay, you know what, you have this social website, you are one of our customers, and you play our game. The top 1%, you had 15 minutes head start for sales. So before the sales start, I will tell you this. For instance, they use it, American Express in 2006, made the ticket available for Rolling Stones, available 1 month before to their customer, okay? So you are one customer of us, we give you access to something particular. So as I said, the thing is this: consider Guild doesn't pay anything for giving you this, but it has a service for you because you have been a good player for them, you did some stuff for them, but they pay you with something that is very tangible for you, intangible for them, okay? Which is the trick. And then power. Power is used in certain ways. So for instance, in certain gamification system, I can say the user that are more experienced, they have the power, for instance, to open up their own blog. No? Okay, I could have the World of Warcraft website, and I said everybody who has level 60 and above can have their blog, or in the British Airways has more than this, or in TripAdvisor and more than this review, he can open his blog, a travel blog, right? So I give you power. There is a thing that you can imagine. Well, why they don't give you stuff? Okay, but because stuff is expensive to them. It's actually the worst thing they can do. And it's also, in terminal psychologically speaking, is the worst. It's the least powerful of all reward prices that you can have. We are going to see why in a minute, okay? In a certain way, it's something that is tangible. So you can win a pen. I win the pen, I'm done. Instead, status, it's status access is something that is intangible. It's always present there. One of the trick here is that actually players cannot accurately price status. So if I tell you, if you are a good student, I give you access to, to the cafeteria. The cafeteria opens for you 15 minutes before the other ones, okay? Or you are a loyal customer to us as our airplane company, and I make you cut the line, you know? For instance, you do the check-in at home, you print your stuff, you do all your stuff, and then I give you the quick access. That's a typical thing that people overvalued. So for instance, I can tell you, participate to this gamification. Help me, analyze my things, and I will give you, I will make you meet Lady Gaga for 10 minutes, you know? The thing is this. Well, if they tell me for AC/DC, I would do that. I probably would do that. I would say, oh my God, I can meet AC/DC, really? I can have, I can say hello to Angus Young? Oh my God, that's amazing. I'm overvaluing it, and probably the company, which could be the record company, basically to have some weird guy say hello to Angus Young, it doesn't cost nothing. But all my work I put there, I put my soul in it, right? So that's amazing. And why do I put my soul in it? Well, because basically they work on my motivation, right? And there are several approaches to work on motivation. So for instance, I can tell you, don't smoke, it's bad. It kills you. Is it effective as a method to say non-smoke? No, because you remember these things because all the people smoking are around with this sign. Everybody see them, everybody smokes. I was in Melbourne last year and I saw this poster and it was amazing because it doesn't say smoke kills. It would say, if you stop smoking, something like in 12 months, your risk of heart disease has halved. You say, oh my God, yes. Even if I smoke a little bit, I may have a heart disease, a heart risk. And if I stop today, in a year, I cut in two my probability of having this problem. Or in 3 months, my lung begins to improve, so I breathe better. So, this is really motivating. Then I went to, I think it was Conad, yes. I went to Conad in Sardinia, I bought my stuff, and there was this, you bought 71.92% of Sardinian product. And this is a social choice for Sardinia. The first thing I said, okay, what is not Sardinian, next time I won't buy it, right? Because that's actually trigger my motivation. The people who studies this, it's basically people that are interested in how reinforcement work to us. And the more basic approach to this is basically a certain amount of time I give some pellet of food to some animal, mouse or whatever, and the mouse will receive some pellet. How the mouse behave to this? It behaves that it does stuff, then it goes back every time at the right time to get things. It's actually like people working in an environment and getting money on some period of the month, and then they go to get money on some period of the month, and they are rewarded, right? So for instance, this type of reward is the least engaging of all, right? Then you have the worst part. It is basically the operant conditioning or the variable ratio, variable schedule reinforcement, where basically you have a lever and the animal can get reward by pushing the lever. And so basically what happens is basically sometimes it gets it, sometimes it doesn't. So isn't that basically like us playing slot machine? You put money, no, yes, no, okay. And that's another type of reinforcement. So this is causes addiction, typically. And that's if you check out how much reward you get, how much response you have that fixed time interval, for instance, doesn't work. So for instance, for gamification, you wouldn't use it. You can use it this one, but actually, you have to use it very carefully. So you can add some elements of that type of reward, but it cannot be too much, because otherwise you have a slot machine effect, okay? So one of the things that you have to, and these are the basic principles, but how do you think to understand really how you can reinforce people and motivate people to to do some stuff as players in your gamification experience and to design that experience, you have to think what they move. So generally speaking, you think about intrinsic or extrinsic motivation. Intrinsic is, I want to do it because it's right to do it. And extrinsic is, I want to do it because people, I will get something from that, right? Typical thing is that extrinsic motivation is much worse as effective, whereas intrinsic motivation work much better. But this is just one view. Other people have completely different views. So for instance, there are three different views I wish to show you. There are much more, but these are three fundamental views. There is Daniel Pink's in Drive. So basically, for instance, is that if you have a creative task, I want to make you build origami, and there is an experiment about origami and other stuff. If I give you money for this, then basically your performance is very low. So for instance, if you want to push people in a creative task, you should avoid actual physical reward and intrinsic motivation, because typically the intrinsic motivation is much more powerful. On the other hand, for instance, you may say the thing that I told you, you know, that most of the people think, people don't work in my company, I want to increase productivity, so I will put leaderboard, because everybody will, everybody is competitive, everybody will compete, and everybody will produce more. Actually, if you have highly competitive people, basically they might disrupt the experience and they might actually be detrimental to your experience, because hyper-competitive people will continue to try to figure out even to beat their own teammates, and you don't want that in an experience that, for instance, it's a gamification to improve team working, or as a team working a team working setup. There is an effect that is the average justification and replacement bias. So it basically tells you, suppose that I want to run, right? I want to run, I like to run, and I have this intrinsic motivation. If somebody comes and they tell me, I give you 10 euros for every run you do, that will destroy completely my intrinsic motivation. Worse, if you don't give me the money anymore, I won't have no intrinsic motivation to run anymore. So for instance, you can have experiments with kids. So suppose that you have kids, like your nephew, and you say, if you eat the greens, I give you $10, right? Maybe he was eating a little bit of greens and you wanted to improve that, right? Because he liked that. But if you give those money and you give an extrinsic motivation, whereas there is an intrinsic motivation existing, what you have basically, you destroy an intrinsic motivation and basically you completely destroy that. For instance, there is a nice experiment. There is a nice experiment in daily care where there was a school that had a problem. So parents would arrive late to pick up kids. So the school had to remain open with the kids there, waiting for the parents. So they decided to say, okay, if you come late, I ask you for 20 euros. Do you think that the number of parents leaving the kid there increased or decreased? It increased, because basically I said, okay, I pay 20 euros, you can stay there two or 3 hours, who cares? I pay for that, you know? It's not a fine, it becomes a service, so keep the kid, I have no problem, I give you 20 euros, it's okay for me. Okay, so that's actually exact what you have with the over-justification effect. One of the approaches that, for instance, is used in this book, it's one of the most famous books about gamification, that's actually that you should leverage self-determination theory. And so basically self-determination theory says that, as I said, the behaviorism approach, the fact that I give you external reward and you will do stuff, doesn't work, okay? Because the idea is this. Take the camera lottery, speed camera lottery. Why did they do that? Do they do that just for the money? You could say a behaviorist, like one that works with fixed time interval reinforcement, might say, yes, obviously, they want to get the money. They did it. But on the other hand, think about when you see in some road and they say your speed, you see the limit, like 50, and then there is this sign that measures your speed. They said you are 55. It's not sure that they give you the fine. Okay, there is no policeman around. It's basically nowhere. You still slow down, right? So there is an effect on that that is only that is giving you just not because of the external reward. And you should do that. And you should basically, if you design and experience for gamification, you should actually try to push that. Okay? The thing is this, that if you think about a reward and you assume that people will actually work for the reward, you might actually, you are not considering something that is really powerful, that is our push toward doing better, toward improvement, our intrinsic. And the point is also that if you put external reward, what you have what is called a hedonic treadmill. When you get accustomed to rewards, if you leave them out, then everything is crashed. So if you pay me, for instance, if you pay me, for every student who came into my office, I would do normally. A student come to my office and he said, can I talk to you? Yes, sure, come to my office and we talk. And he told me, for every student comes to my office, to your office, you are going to get $10, right? And they say, okay, I start doing like this to increase my wage. And then suddenly say, no, we don't have money anymore, sorry. Can I go come to your office? No, sorry, I'm not paid for that, right? Because you basically took my intrinsic motivation, talking to a student that I was interested in, into a topic, you put money, you brought away the money, then basically my intrinsic motivation just crashed. And that's very dangerous. What self-determination theory says that basically you should take the task into hand and consider what type of task is this. Suppose that you have a task that is completely unmotivational, so something that nobody wants to do, no way. Do you want to, I don't know, I cannot imagine a task like this, but suppose that there is something that nobody would do for intrinsic motivation, right? In that case, extrinsic motivation is the only way, okay? But as much as you move toward this end, to the task that highly increased motivation, do you want to help people and give food to the poor and go to Caritas and help give food to the poor? And there is a huge intrinsic motivation. The more you come here, the least extrinsic motivation you should say. So it's good to give reward, extrinsic reward when you're there. It's very bad to give extrinsic reward when you're here. And this is actually what happens, okay? So for instance, in a certain way, for instance, you might say there is a middle part where you say an identification, you say, I can do it because I see some value in it, okay? They ask me to do some stuff, I would say, yes, but I see some value in it, I do it anyway, right? So in self-determination theory also works on three aspects, on competence, the fact that you must feel competent in doing this stuff, your autonomy, like in a game, you must feel autonomous and able to do whatever you play hard, play soft, whatever you like. And also the thing you're doing go beyond just the game. And for instance, one of the sites that use it, one app that use this stuff, it's Fitocracy. I don't know whether you tried it. It's basically one of those social networks for fitness. And actually they have all the aspects, the fact that the all three aspects, like autonomy, competence, and relatedness, are all implemented into that in three different areas. Okay? Now, what I give you so far, it's basically the principle of gamification. So if you want to design, first of all, if somebody comes to you and says, I want to have a site, I have a site, a website, and I want to increase people coming, and let's do gamification and put badges, leaderboard, blah, blah, blah. If it pays high, do it, but otherwise consider that it's not really the best. It's quite plain. If everybody do it, it's not really interesting. If somebody, since you just came from the other side, now you're a game designer and you want to, you've always been a game designer, right now you refresh your memory. Suppose that now comes to you somebody and says, I have a problem, I want to have people come into my company and get loyal to my brand, please build me a game, run. Because basically, yes, if they pay a lot, build the game, but then don't bound the money to the amount of customer they will going to have, because games are really bad in getting people in. I mean, people who makes game, the second effort they have to make is to get the player, because you have to take the player in, okay? So, and one of the things that you have to leverage, suppose that you want to really make this a gamification experience, which could be several things, try, in any case, to work on a good part of people, on the part that that's basically you have for free. People wants to do, for instance, I don't like, I run. Every time I put my shoes on, I said, oh my God, why I run? Yesterday I was in my gym, I was doing, I do a karate class, and I was really tired. I said, why I'm doing karate today? I should have. But still, for instance, the fact that I have an intrinsic motivation to this, the fact that there were my friends there, that are everybody, that I know, that everybody is feeling the same at some point in their life, that everybody, you know, one day it's me that I don't want to, another day it's Massimo, my friend that doesn't want to, but being together and everybody struggling to do it at the best, in a certain way help us, and our intrinsic motivation helps. If they would say, you know, we pay you $10 for every karate class you get into and you train, probably I would say, okay, today I don't train, I won't get the $10, who cares? I put value to something that should be intangible. And so you have to consider this. So if when you design the experience, consider the task, the type of task. If it's a motivational, you have to give money. If there is a big intrinsic push, don't give anything ever, because otherwise you crash everything. Now, to end up, let's sum up. First of all, there is a big misconception in gamification, is that typically is that it regards game. And he said, if you do it, if you build it, they will come. Actually, it is, it will come, but actually I put they will come. It's basically the idea that if you build the gamified experience, surely people will arrive, obviously. Why they don't? I put badges, I put leaderboard. I made a game for that. Why they shouldn't? Because if I make a game about Super Mario 3, I have to find the players for Super Mario 3. It's not that since there is a game, there are players. Actually, that's the worst, most difficult part. One of the things for me, it's all about engaging users. In this case, it's actually really related to game design, because you can design games for several reasons, also because you want to make a point, like in Unmanned or in other games. But actually for me, and for several game designers, you love people laughing and enjoying your game. So the point is to engage the users and rely on their inner motivation, intrinsic motivation. You should consider always that users want to have a degree of mastery. So they start as newbie, so they start completely inexperienced, but they want to see the progression. So you have to plan ahead. One of the things is that when you design a gamified experience, don't put yourself as a mountain that you have to climb. Like I want to, this is the difficulty, and I'm implementing the difficulty, and you user, you should overcome this difficulty. Actually, you should be the Sherpa, you should be the coach. You should be the coach that tells the player, don't worry, you have to do this, let's do it together, I can help you, right? And actually, this is a very good trend in education. In education right now, several trends in education says that me talking to you in this way is wrong. We should collaborate together, and I should be your coach to building your gamified experience, for instance. Think about the design ahead. You're going to design for somebody who starts the gamified experience, but he has to grow with that. So your customer in 1 year is going to be, or your user in 1 year is going to be much better. You have to design the whole experience. If you wonder then, I didn't talk about serious games, and maybe somebody would expect this. Should I talk about serious game? No. Why? Because they are games, okay? They are games. They are games with a certain target, with a certain goal, but they are not a gamification experience. They are games, okay? So they have the same problems as games. So if you take one of the most, consider one of the most interesting example, that is Darfur is Dying, which basically takes you to the, makes you be one of the people in Darfur, and so depending on what you do, you have to do your stuff. Obviously, this is a serious game. Your thing is, your goal is survive in Darfur. If you are a kid, most of the time you're going to try to find water and try to escape people that are trying to kidnap or kill you, right? So they give you this experience. Actually, they give you this experience, but it's not a gamification per se, okay? Because it's still a game that wants to teach you something. There is not, in a certain way, also as a mechanic, not much difference between this and this war of mine. Okay, and actually, I advise you to read this War of Mine, to play this War of Mine. This War of Mine. If you check out the books, there are two main books about gamification. This one, which was also used in the first MOOC they made on gamification. It's actually Kevin Werbunch is actually very nice. There is this guy Gabe Zickerman. That made this book, Gamification by Design, is very nice. He actually has a certain, he is against self-determination theory. He says sometimes extrinsic motivation should be used, and self-determination theory is not that nice, that effective. So you shouldn't say intrinsic motivation is always better. You can, actually there are several views about this. Read and decide on your experience. There are several videos. Several videos online. I took this. That is, I put a link on this. That is probably the oldest one. It's 2010. It was the beginning of the gamification, and that it considered several things as the basics. Congratulations. You unlocked the level. You have the badge for attending this seminar and resisting up to 12:30. If you have a question, I'm here. Thank you.